through him. And I know that today he has another message for us from God. Before he speaks to us, let me take the opportunity to welcome two special people here today. We miss you tremendously. And I was asking, but we are happy that you're here today. God bless you. And also, before Pastor speaks to us, we will sing together number 206, Face to Face Shall I Behold Him. We will sing stanzas 1, 2, and 4. Stanzas 1, 2, and 4. Let us sing this song with joyful hearts, knowing that soon and very soon, we will see our Savior's face. All right? Let us stand as we sing that song.
Face to face with Christ, my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? When in rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ, who died for me.
Thank you. I want to take the time this morning to share with you a few thoughts, a few things that impressed me while I was away. I had the opportunity of attending the pastoral convention there in Austin. One of the things that we received, the pastors received a gift. I have my little gift here today. It was especially prepared and published by the Andrews University Press. There's a little note in my book that says, "This professional gift edition, professional gift edition of the book Christ Object Lessons." And we were asked, Elder Henry, you'll see a bill for that someday. We were asked to commit to sharing this book with at least 5 clergymen who are not Seventh-day Adventists. Now, they said at least, and so they packaged the books in bundles of 5. So I got 5, and I will make an effort to ensure that some of my clergy friends who are not Adventists do receive copies of this specially prepared professional edition of the book Christ Object Lessons. I already have 2 clergymen in mind. While we were away, we were asked to assist with a funeral service. My wife and I spent an entire day assisting with a funeral service of a clergyman who was not Adventist. And so I had the opportunity of meeting a few clergy from another faith. And I promised one of them that I would send a gift. I will send one of these. And then while we were here on Tuesday, the funeral director walked into my office to do business, and he noted a book on my desk in the office. You were there. And he asked, he said, "Can I have a copy of this book?" He knew the book. And it sort of blew my mind, because that's a clergyman. I think, maybe, I'm not sure if any of you knew the funeral director who was here on Tuesday. As he introduced himself to me, he told me he also pastors a church. He told me the name of the church and all of that, but at my age, you can't expect me to remember all of that. But he left his business card with me, and I promised to send him a gift. But there he was, a clergyman from another faith, and he was interested in a copy of a book that was written by Ellen G. White. He knew the book. The book actually is sitting on my desk right in there. It's a big, thick book entitled Triumph of God's Love. And they don't even publish it anymore that way. But he knew the book. I promised that I would send him a gift, and I certainly will send him one of these. And if you, any of you, do have a clergy, do know a clergyman who is not of our faith, and that clergyman is your friend, or some kind of relationship you have with that clergyman, and you'd like me to share one of those books, I'd be happy to do so. It's one of the things that came out of the convention that I thought would be a good thing, a nice thing for us to do. And so, East New York, unknown to you, we committed ourselves to doing this, to share the special edition Christ Object Lessons with 5 clergymen who are not members of our church. So we had a good time. I had the opportunity of attending the seminars. There were seminars, there was a worship experience in the morning, and then there was a worship experience in the afternoon, and there were seminars for pastors. There were seminars for pastors' wives and for the pastors' children. The pastors' children, there were special things prepared for the pastors' children. JC was with us, and she was proudly wearing her T-shirt, proud to be a pastor's, a PK, pastor's kid. And they did quite a few things. They took the children out on different things, different exercises, and so we had a good time. The seminars were very exciting and interesting. I was fully invested in what was going on. I'd be up 6 o'clock in the morning. Our hotel was located at about 20, 25, 30 minutes walk from our hotel. I would leave those two ladies in bed, and I was so invested in what was going on. I would walk to the convention center. I would take that walk, 30-minute walk, to the convention center. They would ride in a taxi later on to join me. But I was so excited about what was being shared. And 6 o'clock, I'll be up and getting ready to head out. And they had seminars all the way into the wee hours of the night, early morning, for those who could stay up that late. There was a lot of stuff happening there. While we were there, there was a whole lot of buzz about what occurred down at the U.S. Supreme Court. I think you do know that now it is pretty okay if you want to be married to someone of the same sex in most of the United States. Now, by a single vote, the Supreme Court has cleared that that legal hurdle. So there was a lot of buzz about that and the implication. How does that affect our church? And I attended a seminar there presented by one of the legal experts that was brought in from Andrews University. And there was standing room only. They had to close the door. Everybody wanted to get an update as to how does that affect us? What are we going to do as a church? Should we marry John and Jim? Would we be required to marry Mary and Jane? And one of the good things, I think it was a good piece of information that was shared, was the fact that apparently there is something in the law that gives religious organizations the ability to opt out. And some of you were asking me about this even before. And so we were told that for now, we should not worry too much about it. But I think you're aware that coming out of the general conference session that followed, the general conference, they updated our church manual, and they have ensured that our church manual will read correctly going forward. You'd be surprised to know that the word partner was embedded in our church manual, referring to a couple. Now that word was okay 10 years, maybe 15, 20 years ago. That was a good word. But that word is a bad word today. You cannot refer to a couple as partners, because that has a totally different connotative meaning today than it did 25 years ago. Because partners typically now refer to two guys or two girls. So our church manual is going to be updated to read, when you read our manual now and it refers to the marriage relationship, it will clearly state that a marriage is that of a commitment between a man and a woman. That's going to be a significant change. No partners anymore. and we will share with you, Elder Rene was asking this morning, for us to organize special meetings, and the Sister Henry has agreed to insert some things in the bulletin going forward, so that those of you who were not quite up to speed with all of the things going on at the GC, things that you need to know about. We will gradually roll out a few things so that we can share some of these updates with you going forward. So my wife and I were able to attend that seminar on how that whole vote down there at the Supreme Court is going to affect us. One of the things that caught my attention, and I want to share with you for the next couple of minutes, maybe two. I think I'm going to share maybe two of those with you. There are several in that category, but there are some current trends, theological and intellectual trends, that we need to be aware of. And maybe before I get to that, let me finish up this, what I was telling you about the marriage thing. Now, you know, when God created Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, there were a couple of things. There are two major institutions that came out of the Garden of Eden. One is marriage, the other is the Sabbath. And